Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents People First, the 5 steps to pure human connection and a thriving organization. By 3 Carpenter and Jackie Carpenter. Foreword by Tommy Spaulding. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Foreword by Tommy Spaulding. What is the definition of a broken record? If you Google the words broken record, you get the literal definition. A damaged record that repeats part of a recording over and over again. I have been blessed to study and teach leadership, particularly servant leadership, for nearly 30 years. I've had the honor of working with thousands of companies to develop their leaders and build successful cultures. Let's call these organizations Company A. They have a culture that puts people over profits. They hire and train their people to be heart-led leaders. They are people-oriented and results-driven. And their employees feel loved, trusted, valued, and appreciated. Unfortunately, though, there are too many companies out there that put profits over their people. Let's call them Company B. Their leaders are self-serving. Their cultures are quite often cancerous. Their employees are desperate for stronger leadership and suffocating under their workload because they are not valued within the organization. When a company only cares about profits, its people are miserable. The culture is toxic. Turnover is higher, and success is fleeting. I hear this story over and over again. Company B organizations, to put it simply, are a broken record, stuck in a repeat pattern of a bad or indifferent behavior towards employees. Yet sadly, there are more Company Bs than Company As. I have dedicated my professional life to change this broken record. It's why I teach youth and leadership teams around the world that there is a different way to lead. There is a different leadership philosophy that truly values people. I call it heart-led leadership. My friends Three and Jackie Carpenter call it people first. For far too long, employees have been thought of as tools to build profits. But what if employees were seen as people first, as human beings with needs, feelings, and dreams? What if employees were cared for, nurtured, and loved by their supervisors, managers, and executives? When business leaders get out of their own way and boldly lead with their people's best interests in mind, not their own, that is when servant leadership is taken to a whole new level. People first is a mindset, a philosophy, and a conscious practice that creates the kind of company culture where employees want to go to work, not feel like they have to go to work. It's invigorating, not suffocating, because it creates teams of people who are working together with passion and purpose. I have known Three and Jackie for well over a decade. They have volunteered at our National Leadership Academy youth program, national-leadershipacademy.org. They have become professional peers, and they are dear and lifelong friends of my wife, Jill, and me. Three, Jackie, and I sing from the same score sheet. We understand that by loving and serving our people, organizations not only flourish, they produce better results in the long term. It is not love or results. It is love-driven results. Three and Jackie are the opposite of a broken record. They are relatable and real. You can feel their contagious energy and passion for people as they explain how to build up employees, how to create loyal team members, and how to generate better organizational results through the people-first mindset. they take you on a transformational journey from a transactional work environment, a broken record, to an upbeat, energetic culture where employees are connected, engaged, and working together as a unified team. The steps listed in this book are actionable, easy to understand, and most importantly, they work. I love this book because 3 and Jackie don't just tell you why loving your employees is powerful. They show you how to love your employees. Read this book and let's stop the broken record of self-serving behavior and toxic leadership. People first matters. And believe me, when you get it right, it will be music to your ears. Chapter 1. Introduction. If your actions create a legacy that inspires others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, then you are an excellent leader. Dolly Parton. Wouldn't it be amazing if employees came to work every day excited, happy, and eager to do their best? What if your employees loved their jobs so much that positions with your company were highly coveted? How awesome would it be if your employees were fully engaged and ready to fully contribute every day? What could be possible for your organization if this were all true? Does it sound like a fantasy? Well, maybe it's not. We believe you can develop loyal employees who take ownership of their jobs and stick around, producing long-term value for your company, all while operating with excellence. We believe it because we've seen it. We've lived it. The truth is that if you create a situation where your employees are winning, your company will be winning too. Our careers have been in the niche industry of private clubs, country clubs, golf clubs, city clubs, and so forth, where members spend hundreds of thousands of dollars just to be able to walk in the doors and take part in the amenities, activities, and events our clubs offer. In an industry where customer expectations are the absolute highest possible, we've been able to create teams that flourish. First of all, yes, my name is 3. I was born a 3rd, and from the day of my birth, my parents called me 3, a sort of permanent nickname. It was one of the best gifts my parents could have given me, because it inspired my unique way of thinking and my ability to stand out from the crowd. I'm the only 3 I've ever met. This fueled my capacity to think, act, and lead differently, too. When I was 12, I began working at my little hometown country club that happened to be 50 feet from the door of my childhood home. I officially got paid to work when I was 14, and at 16, I trained with the club's new head golf professional. At 23, I had landed the general manager job. I realized at a very young age that I was blessed with a natural ability to lead others. Yet I quickly discovered that my leadership style was very different from others in that role. Like me, Jackie began working in the hospitality industry when she was young. She was essentially managing her small hometown bar restaurant when she was 19, and by the time she was 24, she was overseeing a team of nearly 300 employees at one of the most exclusive clubs in the country. Jackie and I worked together for several years and made a great team because I was the high-level visionary and she was the best operator and implementer I've ever known. But long before we were married, we discovered our passion, energy, and genuine care for others were what made us a dynamic duo. Over the years, we have worked at elite private clubs across the country and had some incredible experiences. But what makes us the most proud of our achievements are the accomplishments of those we've helped along the way. We've received dozens of letters, calls, and messages from former employees over the years that document how their lives were positively impacted by their time at our clubs. From telling us how they learned a great deal about leadership to thanking us for genuinely believing in them, it is humbling to know how much we've influenced others simply by paying attention to them. That is the reason we are writing this book. Let's be clear, though. We aren't the CEOs of Google. We did not run a Fortune 500 company or manage thousands of people every day. We are normal people running average-sized businesses. So if we can do it, so can you. Yes, the contents of this book can indeed spark change in large organizations, but it can also be implemented at the local car dealership or a small-town florist shop. The results are the same, because when you support, educate, and love your employees enough to help them succeed, your company will benefit as well. The business world has been poorly programmed to believe that employees are just cogs in a machine, nothing more than tools used to build a profit. After years of researching and developing a process that supports employees at every phase of their career, Jackie and I made an incredible discovery. The way we treated our employees and the environment we created at our clubs, things we thought were what most successful companies were doing too, was not the norm in most organizations. In fact, we were amazed to find that our mode of operation was actually very rare. We've poured our souls into this book because we want to shift the way the business world functions. We want employers of all sizes to stop thinking with a churn 'em and burn 'em mentality because employees are a dime a dozen. We want companies to look at employees as precious resources that must be treasured and nurtured because it is the right way to treat people. And living by this code is the only way to achieve lasting success. This book is written for HR departments, managers, owners, leaders, and line-level employees who aspire to move up the ranks. You can apply the principles in this book at various levels and change the fabric of the organization at its core. We have done this on a smaller entrepreneurial scale. We came up with a program that seems to have worked, and we've implemented it at our clubs over the years. It changed those organizations and the people involved. Because of that, we want to share it with you. One of the signature elements of this book is genuinely loving employees. Love? In business? Yes! That is exactly what we are doing. This isn't the normal language in business. We were always scared to use that word, but our good friend and best-selling author Tommy Spaulding preaches that managers must have servant hearts and lead their people with love. Customers, employees, and the community. His book, The Heart-Led Leader, validated our belief that love in business can absolutely transform an organization. But we know the core of it all starts with your people, your employees. And the chapters ahead don't just tell you why you should love your employees, they show you how to love your employees. It took us 4 years to dissect our approach, define our beliefs, and document our behaviors to create a model that any business leader can replicate in any organization, no matter the size, and see positive change. When we started writing this book, the economy was booming, and the labor pool was continuing to tighten. It was an employee's world, with employers struggling to find and retain talented workers. Then the COVID-19 crisis hit. Suddenly, thousands of businesses were closed, entire industries were at a standstill, and millions of people were out of work. The pandemic forced us to work, think, and operate differently. People experienced numerous challenges, trying to find a job, working from home, homeschooling children while working from home, adapting to a rapidly changing marketplace, and working on the front lines. We saw each other's pain points, and more than ever, we ached for human connection. Employers must recognize that the human element in business is more important than ever. The pandemic changed the structure of the work environment, and although many examples in this book took place in a physical work environment, they still apply to a remote or altered work environment, because people first really hasn't changed. And regardless of good or bad economic times, employees are the heart of every business. Today's business world is evolving, but it has a long way to go. Whether in good economic times or bad, it is no secret that employees have been disengaged from their work. Gallup conducted a comprehensive survey of the U.S. workplace in 2017. The report from 31 million respondents found that the old ways of managing employees just aren't working, and change isn't optional. We've heard this anecdotally from others over the years as well. At a meeting of the Business Roundtable in 2019, Jamie Dimon, the chairman and CEO of J.P. Morgan Chase, vowed that the chief executives from 192 large companies were committed to delivering value to American workers for the future success of the organizations, their communities, and the country as a whole. No longer can the primary goal of corporations be maximizing shareholder profits. The Business Roundtable affirmed the shift in culture the business world must make. In order to create a sustainable future, companies must establish healthy work environments that support the growth of employees and promote the betterment of their communities. The fact that this is the main focus of such an influential group speaks to the importance of this issue. We've got to come together and prioritize what really matters in our organizations, our people. This book will teach you the art of creating a business that is not just employee-centric, but one where executives and employees are joined in partnership. Even in the challenging times we've recently faced, creating this kind of culture has proven to be beneficial for the people and advantageous for the bottom line as well. We've designed this book to be all-encompassing for employers and will walk through every step of the employee life cycle, from recruitment to hiring to training to retention. From our extensive research, we know there are thousands of articles and dozens of books filled with advice for business leaders. Topics range from key questions to ask during interviews, to giving actionable feedback on performance, to creating a positive work culture. Yet we found there wasn't one comprehensive approach. That's why this book is different. When you look at the whole picture, it may be overwhelming to think about all the changes that need to be made in your company. It will be a process, and it won't happen overnight. But you have to start somewhere and build from there. A few years back, I had an artist draw me a picture of a man eating an elephant. It's hanging in my office as a constant reminder that change is slow. I want things fixed immediately, but this image helps me remember that the only way to eat an elephant or make big organizational changes is one bite at a time. Don't be overwhelmed, be focused. Are you ready to get started? Great. But before you do, we have one caveat. This book is not about us. We just feel compelled to share our message, and in doing so, we share our stories and experiences. Be prepared to dive deep into yourself, because this book is really about you. How you act, how you think, how you treat coworkers, how you prioritize job duties, and much more. So join us on this journey. Dig in to engage on a whole new level. It's time to jump off the struggle bus and forge the path ahead to a thriving organization. Chapter 2. Disconnection. When we strive to become better than we are, everything around us becomes better too. Paulo Coelho. I was confidently sitting at the end of the table in the first job interview of my life. It was 1992, and I was interviewing for the general manager's position at my small hometown country club, where I had grown up. As members around the table questioned my ability to distinguish between being an employee rather than a child of a member, I quickly realized that I wasn't their optimal choice for the position. It was the answer to the next question, though, that accidentally propelled my career forward in ways I didn't yet understand. 3. What will you do as the leader of our club? Having grown up at this country club, I had always wondered what it might be like to run the club one day. So I was fully prepared for this tough question. A little nervous, I took a deep breath and said, "Well, I'm going to change the attitude and morale of the staff, the members, and the community. First, I'll create an environment where employees are respected and where they enjoy working. Next, I'll show our members that belonging to this club can enhance their lives and the lives of their families. Thirdly, I'll work to make sure the club is seen in a positive light by those in our community." With that answer, I won over the interview committee and was offered the job. The answer to that question worked so well that a few years later, when I was interviewing for the general manager position at an even bigger club, I used the same answer. I was all but patting myself on the back, waiting for their applause and nods of approval, when the gentleman on my left said, "3, I know you can have an impact on our staff, and I can even get to the fact that you'd be able to impact the attitude and morale of our membership. But just exactly how are you going to change the perception of our club in the community?" I sat quiet for a minute to respond as thoughtfully as possible and said, "Well, sir, you've discovered my secret. The truth is that I'm only really going to focus on the first thing, the staff. The employees will exceed member expectations and create a place where they are proud to belong. Members will be so pleased and impressed with what we are doing that they will go around telling others in the community about our club, ultimately creating a positive image of us within our city." I landed that job too, but not because of some answer that sounded good in the interview room. It was because I had a vision for what I was going to do and a plan for how I was going to execute it. I didn't know it at the time, but what I was really saying was, I was going to create a positive work culture. I focused first and foremost on the employees, their attitude and morale, and, as a result, the members and the community perceived the club in a more favorable light. Many believe that the most important people in any business are the customers, because without them, you have nothing. While that is true, I have always believed that the most important people in any organization are the employees. They are the ones who interact with the customers. They are the people who build the products and provide services. They are the ones who make small decisions that add up to big dollars. Employees are the lifeblood of a business, and without them, you would have no customers. We agree wholeheartedly with Richard Branson, the founder of the Virgin Group, who says, "Take care of your employees, and they'll take care of your business." When bosses treat employees like objects, it's often because of a lack of managerial training, a lack of awareness, or an inability to see or understand the ramifications of their actions. Employees are people, not things. Treating employees like human beings who have thoughts, feelings, and needs is what we call people first. To us, it's all about putting our people first, and in fact, it's the core of everything we do. Every person desires to feel valued and respected. So shouldn't we be creating this kind of environment in our organizations? You know the saying, employees don't quit jobs, they quit bosses? A 2018 study about Facebook supports this theory, but not in the way you might think. The study found the reasons the employees were leaving was because their job wasn't enjoyable, their strengths weren't being used, and they weren't growing their careers. Ultimately, who is responsible for designing jobs and managing employee strengths and development? Managers. So if we can teach all our leaders, including line or department managers and supervisors, to first see the person, their needs, feelings, strengths, and passions, and not the position, the title, role, or job duties, then we can create more caring and productive work environments. Choosing a people-first approach is the first step in sparking organizational change and creating positive work cultures. Establishing a workplace where co-workers treat each other with dignity and respect, and where trust and kindness are palpable, is essential for avoiding high employee turnover that costs businesses time and money. When people enjoy their work environment and feel appreciated and needed, they are much more likely to be engaged in their jobs, stay at their companies, and produce better results. An extensive 11-year study, published in a Forbes article, noted the importance of organizational culture. It found that companies that encouraged leadership initiative and highly appreciated their employees produced 4 times more revenue in the 11-year span than companies without this kind of culture. Good intentions. Today we are living in a tech-obsessed world, where the belief is that technology is the solution for efficiency in the workplace. We sit in our workspaces and primarily communicate via emails, text messages, Slack, and other apps, often competing with our ability to really connect with others at work. While technological advancement has improved workplace productivity to an extent, in the last decade, human development, personal development, has been sacrificed for technological development. We've been so distracted by technology that we lost our ability to focus on what's most important, our people. Some years ago, Jackie was recruited to work as a business development professional for a private club in Nashville. The position was new to the company, and the role was new to Jackie, one she had little experience in. Recruiting new members, building private event business, and seeking corporate partnerships were all things Jackie understood, but had never actually done before. She was well-versed in private clubs, yet expressed that she would need the proper guidance and training, especially at the outset. The executive recruiting her assured Jackie he would make introductions to key business targets, attend meetings, and schedule biweekly sessions to coach her and help develop her skills. When Jackie heard he was also a business coach and mentor for other executives, she felt confident that she would be receiving the necessary support to succeed in this new role. She accepted the position, but resigned less than a year later. After months of frustration and floundering, Jackie felt hung out to dry. Only 1 biweekly coaching session happened in 11 months, and the executive all but ignored her. The only time he made a point to talk to her was when he critically complained about her progress and membership numbers. What Jackie thought would be an opportunity to advance her skills and personal development turned into utter disappointment, So she laughed. Unfortunately, Jackie's story is quite common in the business world. While managers and business leaders may have good intentions, broken promises and disappointing work experiences cause high turnover. Workers, especially younger generations, expect guidance, coaching, and development to hone their skills. They also want a sense of purpose in their jobs and to be working for something greater than the company's bottom line. It's hard for employees to be truly connected to their organizations when this isn't the case. Though hiring managers and executives say the development of employees is a priority, it often falls flat, just like Jackie experienced. Many leaders intend to live up to these promises and ensure employees are getting appropriate training and direction, but everyone is so busy and distracted, things can easily fall by the wayside. No one ends up taking the time to actually follow up and follow through. Managers assume workers will just go off and learn to do their jobs. But without the proper mentorship, training, and attention, the whole process falls short. We have to keep our people as the focus of everything we do. Our employees are our most valuable assets. If we want to attract and keep them, we have to prioritize their needs, their growth, and their development over everything else. Many executives jump to invest in new technologies, but don't see the ROI of investing in their employees, their human capital. In 2018, John Deere, a world leader in tractors, lawnmowers, agricultural equipment, and the like, was rated as more innovative than companies such as Google and Facebook. John Deere is committed to delivering cutting-edge technology that provides actionable data and produces efficiency to accelerate farming capabilities. It is constantly working to ensure every inch of farmland is productive and that farmers are able to do more with less. The company understands that as the world's population increases, the world's food and infrastructure needs will increase as well. But there will be less land, water, and natural resources available. As such, it works to manufacture high-tech engines that produce cleaner air emissions than the air going in, build products that are lighter weight, resulting in less soil compaction and reduced runoff, and provide innovative programming to educate smaller farmers across the world to promote their agricultural success. That's the reason John Deere also earned the number one ranking in the area of social innovation, work that primarily benefits society rather than specific individuals or organizations, putting it ahead of Toyota, Ford, USAA, and Honda. Clearly, John Deere's tech advancement is a huge priority, but the company also has a compelling higher purpose: to improve living standards for everyone. People are the priority for John Deere. While the company has an outstanding compensation and benefits program, prioritizes employee growth through education and career advancement, and regularly recognizes employees for their hard work, it is the focus on improving the lives of others that provides true purpose and fulfillment to their employees. John Deere even provides employees paid time off to volunteer and give back to their communities in meaningful ways. Yes, technology and innovation are crucial, but John Deere centers everything it does around inspiring its people to do more for others. The takeaway here is that if we want to advance our companies, we've got to put our people first and invest in their skills, training, education, and passion just as much as we do in technology. While some may think the tech over humans concept is the way of the future, research suggests that human talent is the key factor linking innovation, competitiveness, and growth in the 21st century. Klaus Schwab, founder and executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, says, "Work shouldn't be a race between humans and machines, but a part of life that helps people recognize their full potential." Experts suggest that human talent will become more valuable as technology grows, because humans can brainstorm new ideas, inspire others, and drive organizations to succeed. Technology cannot. Korn Ferry, a global organizational consulting firm, conducted a study that found two reasons why people outperform even the most sophisticated technology: potential and appreciation. An individual's potential is not fixed. It can be influenced, enhanced, and unleashed to benefit the organization. As people grow in knowledge, experience, and seniority over time, they bring even more value to the business. In contrast, machines typically operate at a limited maximum output and depreciate over time. The only way organizations will thrive today and in the future is by creating work cultures where employees are focused on, paid attention to, and cared for, regardless of whether they work inside the company or remotely. Millennials and Gen Z see the workplace differently and want more from their jobs than just paychecks. They want more positive day-to-day work experiences, the flexibility to work from home, and the opportunity to work for companies where they aren't just numbers, but where they can make a meaningful contribution. We have to accept this and find ways to use technology to create or enhance people first in our organizations in order to provide the kind of culture younger generations are seeking. Millennials are the most disengaged generation and consequently change jobs 3 times more often than older generations. Numerous studies confirm that employee retention and turnover have been one of the biggest challenges for businesses, with turnover costing up to 30% of the position's total salary. 53% of employees say they give the minimum effort required in their jobs, so it is no wonder that actively disengaged employees cost the U.S. $483 to $605 billion per year in lost productivity. At the end of the day, we need to care about our employees and mentor our people, regardless of what generation they are in. But we also need to go about it in a way that acknowledges and responds to what is important to them. Technological advancement has complicated our ability to engage in our work. As a society, we are more connected via the internet, yet we are more disconnected from each other than ever before. There is a direct correlation between time spent on the internet and the level of loneliness one experiences. A 2019 Cigna survey reported that 61% of Americans over the age of 18 are lonely, which is an increase from its 2018 study. Technological connection is predominant, but true human connection is drastically missing from our lives. People would rather text than talk, email than converse. Instead of striking up a conversation with a coworker at lunch, we put headphones on and bury ourselves in our phones to avoid each other. A recent Harvard study found that open floor plans actually kill productivity. It decreases face-to-face time by nearly 70% and increases email use by up to 50%. Let's face it, we've created work environments that are cold, detached, and insincere. So, how do we create organizations that people want to work for? How do we inspire a younger generation of workers? How do we create thriving teams, especially when people are working remotely more often? The answer lies in humanizing our businesses and prioritizing our people. Keeping connection at the heart of every aspect of the employee lifecycle will create what we call a culture of LOVE. What is LOVE? It's the loyalty, ownership, value, and excellence that permeates the organization when management invests time and energy in its people, which leads to a symbiotic employer-employee relationship. LOVE naturally occurs when business leaders make it crystal clear that their people are their most important asset, and that helping them learn, grow, and evolve is of the utmost priority. In this type of environment, the flow of information and knowledge is strengthened and leads to genuine and lasting connection. Positive workplaces are created, employers become more credible in the eyes of job seekers, and interviews become candid conversations instead of intimidating interrogations. When all of that is in place, we begin to change the fabric of our organization. Loyalty develops in our people when we first show loyalty as employers. By cultivating and paying attention to them, it ensures they are fully prepared for their new role. Regularly connecting with employees beyond their first few months on the job demonstrates our commitment to their well-being, and in return, we begin to see them take ownership of their roles. Caring about employee successes, failures, and overall development produces long-term value in each individual and ultimately leads to an organization operating with excellence. In this kind of environment, workers are constantly engaging, connecting, sharing, and caring about each other, their work, and the company. We call credibility, candor, cultivation, commitment, and care the five steps to pure human connection in the workplace, and together they create a culture of LOVE. When a culture of LOVE exists, it leads to an organization that functions at a higher level. It creates a win-win scenario where employees are fulfilled and happy, and as a result, the company as a whole is flourishing. People first. We've spent our entire careers engaging our teams, but with challenges catching and keeping people's attention, we've had to directly focus on creating a culture of LOVE. When one of our best employees, Jody, unexpectedly lost her mother 2 days before our biggest, most labor-intensive event of the year, we cringed. Even though Jody vowed to still work the event, we told her to take all the time she needed to be with her family. In all honesty, it was a huge blow not to have Jody for the event, but we knew it was in her best interest to not be at work, and we survived. When Casey, an assistant manager that we spent years developing, told me he was applying for his dream job at Disney, my heart sank. Casey was one of our top employees, who we hoped to keep around for several more years. But we helped him fine-tune his resume, prepped him for his interview, and provided a great reference, because that was best for Casey. Putting your people first isn't always easy, but it is always prioritizing what is best for them, not you. It means you treat your people better, and it matters. A few years ago, Bob Chapman, CEO of manufacturing company Barry Waymiller, wrote a book about his truly human leadership philosophy, where everybody matters. People spend most of their waking time in the office and are very frustrated by the way they are treated week in and week out. Everyone wants to know that who they are and what they do matters, Chapman explained. We found out that how we treat people in our care materially affects how they act towards their spouses and children. Taking care of employees significantly impacts how they will treat others, their families, co-workers, customers, and community members. According to a recent article in Forbes, treating people as valuable members of the company instead of as interchangeable parts can bring about better results. It is an expectation that people will be treated better in today's world. Society is significantly less willing to accept the exploitation of others. Employees want to work for companies they can be proud of and trust to do the right thing. A few years ago, Target embarked on a sensible source initiative and made it a standard business practice to no longer buy products from factories or businesses where workers were abused or mistreated. Target has an entire division whose mission is to monitor compliance and regulation of factories and facilities supplying products to the retail chain, to ensure specific requirements are being consistently met. Child labor, poor working conditions, and excessive work hours, more than 60 per week, are unacceptable, and Target will not purchase goods from suppliers that do not comply. The company is sensitive and empathetic, as it invests tremendous resources in ensuring its people and those of its suppliers are treated properly. Target demonstrates what it means to be a true people-first organization, because when you have a 360-degree commitment to your people, it guides every decision you make. In 1988, Kehlani Ray Rafko was the first registered nurse to be crowned Miss America. In a recent interview with Jackie, she shared that as a nurse, she knew the importance of seeing patients as people first, and it always bothered her that patients were defined as room numbers and illnesses. Patients would be referenced as 48-year-old male with leukemia in 31B. And Kehlani found herself thinking, why aren't we using their names? We are people caring for people. During her time as Miss America, and to this day, Kehlani uses stories about her ability to connect with patients to inspire others. She often tells the story of a young patient she cared for as a nurse. He had a dream of going to Hawaii, but between his disease and the medical expenses, it was not possible. After he learned his prognosis had worsened, Kehlani went to his room dressed in a hula outfit, blared Hawaiian music, and danced a Polynesian dance, which was her talent when she was Miss America. It was truly a special moment that his family treasured long after their son passed away. Sometimes we forget the impact we have on others when we prioritize what really matters. We can easily fall into what Kehlani refers to as the deep ditch of checking things off the list.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.